for that. For those of you who don't know Jason, he was a postdoc in my group 6 years ago. Where did that time go? He got his undergrad and his master's both at the University of Colorado, actually has a PhD, all there. And master's and PhD were done in the Colorado School of Mines, which was actually one of the first things that caught my eye when Jason applied for a postdoc job in my lab working on diarrheal pathogens. It's all deep mining, I don't know. No? Okay. I was going to go with dark hole. Trying to keep it above board. None of the other senior people are here, so that's good. He did a quick postdoc at Colorado School of Mines. Then he came here. He was here for 2 years. And then he actually went off to translational genomics. Which is a for-profit organization.
Non-profit.
And also parlayed that into now being an assistant professor of biology at Northern Arizona University. So, as I mentioned, many of you may know Jason, he developed a bunch of the tools that we still use in our group. And if he touches on all of the topics that he said he was going to touch on, it should be a really important summary.
Great. Well, thank you. Thank you for inviting me back. It's great to be back in Baltimore. So the talk that I want to give today is really talking about how we can use genomics to kind of inform better diagnostics. And so I'll be talking about the genus Burkholderia because that's the project that we were funded on, but hopefully this lab application, you'll see applications for other organisms as well. And so, of course, in diagnostics, what we're really talking about is thinking about three main categories. The first is specificity. So when we go in, when we don't detect an organism, how well can we do that? So this is limiting the number of false positives. In our world, in the select agent world, false positives are a real problem. If you think you have a select agent, it's not actually there. It's a big problem. We also think about sensitivity. So this is where we want to limit our false negatives. And so this is what we think about when we want to make sure we're getting the organism that we are targeting and we're not getting something else. And then limited detection. So especially thinking about clinical samples, environmental samples, how low can we go in terms of a concentration of our target and still be able to detect it? And so this has a lot of implications for clinical matrices where you have a low level infection, how low does that organism have to be in the bloodstream, in the sputum or urine for us to still detect it? So there's several problems and potential limitations that we need to think about and address before we design diagnostics. The first of which is sometimes we don't understand the target very well. So if we don't have a large number of target genomes from a species, you know, you're identifying diagnostics, but you have no idea of the diversity where you actually go into the environment, maybe you're gonna miss a lot of the diversity just because you haven't characterized the target well enough. Then there's the problem of the non-target genome space, and that's where you have a near neighbor genome, for example, who is really similar to your target, but you don't know where it is, you don't know what the genome looks like. And so you go in, you get a lot of false positives, you're actually picking up the non-target rather than the target. And so I'll talk about how some of these issues can be addressed, and we've addressed them through, you know, first step is the design, how will you design the targets, and then validation as well as working in redundancy to allow a little bit of genomic variation and still be able to detect your organism. So we work in the national security realm. So they use diagnostics in lots of different ways. And so there's the BioWatch program that's operated by the DHS where they go out, they deploy air samplers in cities across the country. And so what they do every day, they go, they take the air sampler, the air filter, they take it back to the laboratory, and then they run different assays to see if, you know, different biothreat pathogens have been deployed. And so one of the big issues that they've been running into is with Francisella tularensis. So this is the causative agent of tularemia, but it's actually one of the weaponized strains by the US government. So they weaponized this FT, so it's one of the organisms that they definitely screen for. But what happens is they get a lot of false positives. There's a lot of Francisella tularensis-like things floating around in the environment that they're picking up. And because their assays were designed poorly, they're getting a lot of false positives. And so much of the problem with the FT near neighbors is because they're endosymbionts. They're things that aren't easy to grow in the laboratory. And that's why the near neighbor kind of Francisella space has been so poorly understood. And so the nice thing for us coming in as contractors with the government is it gives us lots of funding opportunities. They have bad assays. they don't understand the genomics very well in some cases, and so they contract with us in order to try to understand that a little bit better. So focusing on the organism that I'll be talking about today, so the genus Burkholderia, the question is why do we care? So primarily they're soil bacteria, free-living soil bacteria. They can be plant symbionts. Plant pathogens, the reason we care, of course, is because they're human pathogens. And so a lot of work that's done in Burkholderia is in the Burkholderia sepatia complex, and that's the organisms that are associated with cystic fibrosis infections. And so what we care about, though, is the select agents. So these are organisms that can be deployed in a biowarfare setting, bioterrorism, and that's why the government's interested in it. So recently, if I had a pointer, it'd be a little bit easier to show this, but the Burkholderia genus now is broken down into two major clades. The top clade, clade one, that contains our pathogens of interest. This clade two has now been called para-Burkholderia. So there's no pathogens in this group. And so what I'll be mostly talking about today is organisms in that top clade one. So Burkholderia pseudomallei, so many people have probably never heard of this organism. It's a gram-negative soil-dwelling organism. That's really a big problem for Southeast Asia. It's present in Northern Australia as well. And in those countries, it's a major cause of septic pneumonia. And so the disease itself is really hard to diagnose. It has lots of different manifestations. And once you are diagnosed, the treatment regimen is really complex. It's a treatment regimen that's similar to tuberculosis, if you're familiar with the amount of antibiotics that you have to go through. The lower kind of figure here shows that the incidence of several different diseases. So melioidosis is the causative, is the disease that's caused by Burkholderia pseudomallei. So the incidence in tropical regions is much lower than diseases like tuberculosis and like malaria. But if you look at the fatality rate, that's about 58%. So once you do get it, if you're not treated quickly, diagnosed and treated quickly, it's a very fatal disease. And the reason why it's a select agent is not only because it causes such a nasty disease, but it's got a really bad inhalational exposure pathway. So you breathe it in, and you get septic pneumonia, and you die pretty quickly, unless you're diagnosed quickly and treated. It's also readily available. So this top figure here, picture is in Thailand. So this is a rice paddy. If you were to go and sample the water, sample the soil, it's just teeming with Burkholderia pseudomallei. So if you wanted to go and grab it from the environment, it's really easy to do so. And it's one of the few select agents that we study that was actually used in warfare. So World War I and the Civil War, trying to kill the other side's livestock. So it's mostly a livestock disease, but it was actually deployed in warfare. And so the US government seems to care about this quite a bit because even though it's a disease that's not present in the United States right now, we have bases. Our war fighters are stationed in many of these endemic countries and as a potential biowarfare agent. So they're very keen in kind of funding research for the diagnosis and then the treatment of the pathogen. So the distribution, if you look at the worldwide distribution, again, it mostly is a problem of Southeast Asia, Northern Australia, but it's in Africa, it's in South America. Before the hurricane, we went on a sampling trip to Puerto Rico and it's there as well. The question is, why isn't it in the United States? So if you go to Florida, Louisiana, so really kind of warm, tropical-like, wet environments, why hasn't it established it there yet? So is it a function of the ecology of the organism? Is it just it hasn't reached there yet, but it's just a matter of time? We don't know the answer to that yet, but for the most part, it's a disease of Southeast Asia. From a genomics perspective, so there's two chromosomes, about 7 megabases, so a fairly large bacterial genome. It's highly plastic, so it's characterized by genomic islands. It's got a pathogenesis that's quite complex. There's no single gene associated with how it causes disease. It's highly recombinant, which complicates timing analyses and other types of things. It has an emerging antimicrobial resistance, and so this is a big problem. If you have a resistant strain, you're trying to treat it with first-line drugs, and they're not effective. If you look at the genomics, so on the right there is a phylogenetic tree that was published this year. The red genomes are from Australia. So based on the genomics, everything we understand, we think it has a probable Australia origin. So the fact we see it so often there, the genomics are also telling that it probably has an Australian origin. So the study of our goal was to identify markers that were specific to Burkholderia pseudomallei and mallei. And so our approach was we wanted to sequence that near neighbor space to reduce the potential false positives. So we went in, I'll talk about the collection strategy. We sequenced 570 genomes from other Burkholderia species that were closely related. We then also wanted to sequence additional Burkholderia pseudomallei genomes to understand the kind of the target genome space. So another 261 genomes. And so once we had those markers identified, the government funded us to design and deliver diagnostics on multiple platforms. So they wanted us to deliver the assays on a MagPix platform because that's an FDA-approved platform, but then also TACMAN, and then we were interested in amplicon sequencing, which I'll talk about in the rest of this talk. And then they want us to validate the assays. So we have a fairly large strain collection of Burkholderia pseudomallei. It's collected from mostly Thailand, but also other places in Southeast Asia. Then they also want us to validate it on real clinical specimens as well as environmental samples. So again, the challenge with diagnostics, a lot of it has to do with the fact that the genome is so plastic. So we see a big reduction in the core genome size. So the core genome, those genes that are present in all genomes of the species. So this was a study that was published back in 2015 with 40 genomes, and they showed basically the more you sequence, the smaller the core genome is, which we see in almost every bacterial species. And this is due to things like geographical variation. You go to a new environment, the organism is maybe adapted to a different environment, it throws out genes it might not otherwise need, as well as strains that have been passaged in the lab that maybe aren't representative of what you'd find in nature, but there's still something that you want to be able to detect, and then host adaptation. So as we see these chronic infections, organisms are losing portions of the genome they don't need anymore, and we wanted to make sure that we could still detect those in those types of kind of host-adapted cases. And then the closely related non-targets, we call this signature erosion, where the more you understand that near neighbor space, the fewer of those diagnostic targets are all of a sudden specific to your organism that you're thinking of. And so these are organisms that are closely related. They're also often living in conjunction with pseudomallei. And so we've seen with this, we published recently this Burkholderia humptiduensis. And so this is a near neighbor genome where we actually see active plasmid gene transfer between organisms. So by understanding this space, we're kind of further defining these diagnostics and how specific they might be. So our collection strategy, so we wanted to amass the largest collection of these near neighbor genomes that we could have, because that's often the limiting factor in many of these studies. We reached out to collaborators who work on cystic fibrosis to get isolates. We actually performed our own isolate collection strategy. So we went to Florida, and we went to Louisiana. We went to these sites that were near kind of wet soils that we would expect pseudomallei to be present if it were there. And so we collected soil samples from there. We also reached out to, we had clinical partners in Australia at the Menzies School of Health Research. And so they had a large collection of near neighbor genomes. So they sent us those as well. For Burkholderia pseudomallei, again, we try to get a diverse geographical collection. We had a patient who's been infected for 15 years, so this is a chronic infection. So we have about 120 different isolates from specimens from this patient. And then we also included these lab passage streams that have been lab for 30, 40 years that have been passage hundreds and hundreds of times. So for the soil, our strategy was we first obtained the soil, we mixed it with water, and we incubated at 37 degrees to kind of get things growing. We then incubated it, transferred it to a medium called ashdowns. And ashdowns is a selective medium containing gentamicin. So the idea there is you kill off most of the soil bacteria, leaving the Burkholderia that are almost all resistant to gentamicin. So we did that 37 degrees for 7 days. And then we plated on ashdowns auger. If it's Burkholderia pseudomallei, you get this kind of fried egg morphology. We then picked 5 colonies, screened them. At the time, they were screening with this REC-A gene, which they used to kind of speciate Burkholderia pseudomallei and near neighbors. If they all looked the same, we picked 1 colony and went forward. If we saw some variation, we picked all the colonies and moved forward. So we tried to understand a little bit of the diversity that was present. So we were, because we were growing it on this kind of selective media, there's obviously a potential bias here. So we're only going to look at those Burkholderia isolates that are resistant to gentamicin. So we've gone back now on the actual DNA extracts, though. We've done REC-A sequencing to try to understand what are we missing by this approach. And what we can figure out is there's some near neighbors that we're missing, but the pseudomallei that are susceptible to gentamicin, there's not that many of them out there that we see. So we sequenced 829 DNAs on the Illumina MiSeq and HiSeq platforms. We also want to go through, and with each clade that we didn't have a good representative, we did PacBio sequencing to get kind of finished or near-finished genome assemblies. We assembled our Illumina genomes with SPACE and our PacBio genomes with HGAP. And so we combined these with whatever was present in GenBank at the time, so about 157 targets and 143 targets. So we looked at a little over 1,100 genomes. So one of the first things that we like to do when we assemble genomes is look for potential contamination. So as a bioinformaticist, I'm always finding contamination in all kinds of different forms. The main ways that we see it, the first is where we see a mixture of different organisms. And so this is, you know, either an indexing error, a laboratory error. Usually it's easy to identify, especially in clonal organisms where we don't expect, you know, a lot of exchange with other species. Phi X is something that we're not supposed to see, but we see it all the time mixed into different genomes. It's also in GenBank and completed genomes. So it's something that can be easy to identify, but it also can be kind of confusing sometimes. And then the last one, which is kind of the most complex, is mixture with the same organism. And this is where you multiplex 100 genomes together, you sequence them all, and there's a certain amount of carryover that happens. We think it might be due to the clustering step in Illumina clustering, but we see it all the time. And what it usually results in is sometimes you get some low-level contigs that have a low coverage. And so this is analysis we did with Acinetobacter baumannii. Most of the contigs had a coverage of about 37. And then there's this tail of really low coverage, relatively small contigs. And so in this case, we found this one gene that I'll talk about next. So when we started looking at the resistance profiles to see why this genome that was supposed to be susceptible when we grew it up in the laboratory, it had genes that made it look resistant to meropenem. So it had this beta-lactamase gene, but it looked like it may also contain this insertion element that is required for antimicrobial resistance of meropenem. So we took the raw assembly, we looked at this value and it said, well, it looks like it's kind of intermediately present in the genome. When we ran spades with the coverage cutoff auto to try to remove those potentially anomalously covered contigs, it was still there, but we went in, we manually removed that tail of low coverage contigs and it disappeared. And we went through with PCR and verified that gene was definitely not present in our genome. So this is a case where these types of contamination can cause problems in certain cases. Here it was about 4 reads that were contigging into this, you know, 400 base pair contigs. So sometimes these types of issues can cause problems, especially when you're looking at sensitive diagnostics between species. All right, so the next step that we did is wanted to download all the genomes from GenBank, so use the information in GenBank that might be kind of useful for our project. And so anybody who works with GenBank knows that there are potential problems, especially with speciation. So what we did, the first thing we did is we downloaded all the genomes from GenBank, and then we wrote a method here, a little script that will go through and it downloads from the assembly database, and then it's gonna rename the genome. So when you download, especially from the assembly database, it's a totally, you know, useless name. It's just the accession number usually. Or whatever the people who submitted called it. So in this case, we're renaming it by the accession number, the species, the strain name, and then the assembly level. And it might be kind of tough to see, but you can see at the end of here, so there's complete genomes, contigs, scaffolds. And so this is useful for if somebody says, hey, go grab all the completed genomes from GenBank. And anyone who's done that manually knows it's pretty brutal. But our method constantly updates, it rebuilds the directory structure and it downloads all the genomes and it keeps up to date. So we run it once a week and it's constantly updating that database just to make it easier on you when you want to compare GenBank genomes. So the next thing we did then is filter those genomes. So a lot of times there's going to be highly questionable quality in those genomes. And so the first thing we did is we filtered things that had a large number of ambiguous nucleotides, so you know anything that was not ATGC. We filtered by an anomalous number of contigs, so we try to figure out what a reasonable number is and then filter out the really kind of fragmented assemblies. We filtered by genome assembly size. So often if you have, you know, you have an expected genome assembly size, if it's way too low, you probably have low coverage that's allowed a lot of regions to drop out. And then if it's too high, you probably have a mixture of different organisms. So we try to identify the normal range and then filter outside of the normal range. And the last thing we filter by is by MASH distance. So MASH is a metric that was published as a way to quickly compare genomes to get a distance value. And so we can compare everything on a pairwise basis, find things that fall outside of the normal range, and then filter those. And then there's manual intervention. You can go in and make sure it hasn't filtered out things unnecessarily. This script also, it'll build this tree, and then it'll annotate the genomes that were removed. And so this is just a clustered dendrogram. So this is Burkholderia thailandensis. These three genomes down here are a different species. They're all called thailandensis, but they're not. And so they're filtered out because they have an anomalous distance. So, oh crud. I don't know how to turn this notifications off here. Just close out of this. They probably happen again too. And so this is just a nice semi-automated way to curate your genome. So you make sure that the species that you're targeting only contains genomes that are actually from that species, and you're not getting cross mixtures of different species. So the code is available there if you're interested, and I can share these slides as well if you want to kind of check out how the method's done. So the next step that we wanted to do is look at the phylogeny. So look at these different genomes, see how they're related in a phylogenetic context. And so what we did is we had all the genome assemblies, we mapped them to a single reference genome. So it's again about 1,100 genomes. We called this SNPs with this NAS pipeline that we published as part of a kind of a NAU TGen collaboration. The benefits to the pipeline is you can use reads or assemblies, you can use multiple short read aligners, multiple SNP callers, you can look at consensus calls of how they agree. It can calculate monomorphics, identify monomorphics as well as polymorphics. So if you're looking at an outbreak and you want to know, okay, I have two SNPs, but out of how many character states? So we're calling every single character state, which is a little unusual for most SNP pipelines. And then it was really optimized for job management systems. So we run Slurm on our cluster, but it should be compatible with Torque, SunGrid Engine, et cetera. But it really takes advantage of the parallel nature of these jobs. All these alignments are done independently, so these are all separate jobs. So we can analyze 1,100 genomes in a couple hours, depending on how many resources you have available. The phylogeny is shown up here. This is the pseudomallei complex. This is the cepacia complex. Here's Burkholderia pseudomallei, so there's a bunch of near neighbors, including five putative new species that we've identified. Three of them fall in that, clade, the pseudomallei complex, which are the most immediate near neighbors to pseudomallei. We also produced whole genome sequencing for another two recently described species where we previously didn't have whole genome sequence. So we really, through this approach, we expanded greatly kind of the known diversity of Burkholderia pseudomallei as well as the near neighbor space. So once we had our species designations figured out, the next thing we did is went through for each clade or species and we identified the core genome. So those are those genes that are present in all the genomes in any given species. And so we used this large score, last score ratio pipeline. So this is something I started working on when I was still here at IGS, and then I kind of kept working on it when I moved to NAU. And so this is a method that just works off of blast score ratio, which I probably don't need to describe in too much detail, except you're going to get a ratio from 0 to 1. 1 means two proteins are exactly identical, and a value of 0 means things are basically, there's no alignment whatsoever. So I went through, once I identified the core genome, we screened that core genome back against all of the genomes to see exactly, to identify markers that have a BSR value of 0.8 or greater in all of our target genomes and a value of 0.4 or less in all of our non-target genomes. So what we're trying to do is define this space in this kind of overlapping circles. This is the core genome of Burkholderia pseudomallei mallei that's not present in any of your neighbors that we know about. Just because this audience is more of a genomics audience, I've made changes to LSBSR recently that might be of interest. I can now compare intergenic regions. Before it was stuck to just coding regions, but as a potential diagnostic, there's going to be valuable information in intergenic regions as well. It can now use Diamond. So Diamond's a method for kind of a really rapid protein-protein alignment, so it can speed up large data sets quite a bit. In the Rory is the Sanger pangenome paper that was published, a method that was published, they mentioned that BSR was slow, and so I went back through recently, and for 2,800 genomes, it took about 80% less time with BSR to analyze 2,800 genomes. So it took, a little over 3 hours to analyze 2,800 genomes. Rory took 849 minutes, and they don't even count their annotation, which when I annotated all these genomes with Proca, it took me about 115 hours of actual processor time spread across the cluster, but still, it can be significantly faster. There are also questions of accuracy, so we've done some analyses to show there's no difference in accuracy between methods. And then recently I've outputted this dendrogram method in BSR. So in the LSBSR paper, I showed that you can cluster things by actual gene content. So rather than phylogenetics, you can say how are genomes related by their complete pangenome content. And so recently I did this, and this has turned out pretty poor, but all these red are Shigella genomes. So Shigella merged multiple independent times from E. coli. When you cluster by gene content, they still all cluster together. So we showed that in this paper, but now this is kind of standard output that you can use to kind of assess how things are related based on their complete pangenome content. All right, so looking at those unique markers, so here is each different species or clade that we identified, the number of markers. So for most of these clades, we did identify genomic regions that seem to be unique to each species. When we looked at the number of markers for Pseudomallei, there were 22. For Pseudomallei and Mallei, there were 38. So not a lot, but enough to form diagnostics from. So this is a tree of Pseudomallei. This is Mallei right here. So what it is, it's a clonal expansion that's emerged from Pseudomallei. It's adapted to the mammalian life cycle, and so it's no longer a free-living soil bacteria. You get a big reduction in the genome, but it's still a select agent. It's still something we want to be able to capture if we need to. By including diagnostic targets for both, either just Pseudomallei or Pseudomallei Mallei, we can kind of refine and identify Mallei kind of through a process of exclusion. So these 38 markers represent, you know, out of the entire Burkholderia pan genome, if you look at the whole genus, there's about 189,000 genes. The pan genome of Pseudomallei, about 18,000. The core genome, about 1,500. And we're talking about 38 genes. So it is kind of a needle in a haystack, but it demonstrates the power of taking a large genomic search space and refining it down to things that are very specific to what you're targeting. When we map the actual markers against the phylogeny, so here's the phylogeny, again, tough to read. This is Pseudomallei Mallei up here. The red indicates highly present genes, white means mostly absent. And around the circle, what we're finding is that the genes, through this visualization, appear to be very specific to the targets that we designed. If you zoom in a little bit, so this is Mallei showing that you have Pseudomallei Mallei markers and those that are just hitting Pseudomallei. So we can see this in a visual way that the targets are behaving as we design them to, as we expect them to perform. So at the onset of the study, there were about 301 genomes in GenBank. We added another 829. The number of specific diagnostic markers, if we just went with the 301 genomes, are about 63. So we removed through this process about 25 potential false negative markers. We also went through and identified 4 to 5 potential false positives, which doesn't seem like a lot, but it seems like every time someone publishes a Pseudomallei assay, I go through and it seems like it's falling into this category where they haven't understood the near neighbor space. There's always going to be some potential misamplification and misinterpretation based off of that. So going back to the core genome reduction, so this is what I showed earlier. So this is the Pub paper in 2015 showed that the core genome reduced with 40 genomes to about 3,300 genes. When we now look at about 400 genomes, you know, if we sampled at their level, we would have found something in the same general range. Now that we're at 400 genomes, it's gone down to about 1,500. And what if we kept sequencing? How low could it potentially go? You know, what is the minimum set of genes required to be a Burkholderia pseudomallei? We don't have the answer to that quite yet. If we look at that idea of signature erosion, this is where the near neighbor genomes are reducing the potential diagnostic markers. If you just took 10 near neighbor genomes out of a hat and you look at the diagnostic targets, there could be about 480 that look specific to Burkholderia pseudomallei. When you go to 300, it converges down to about the 38 markers that we know of. The GenBank level at the time of the study was about here, so there could have been a number of potential diagnostic markers that you had just randomly sampled that could have been potential false positives when you actually took those out to the field and screened for them. There's a number of caveats that come along with this method that we did do. The first of which is the growth on ashdowns, which I already mentioned. It's a potentially biasing result because you're only looking at those Burkholderia that are growing on gentamicin. The other issue is we know that the Illumina genomes are not always fully representative of the complete genome. It's like, you know, putting together the puzzle, but you know you're missing a few pieces. We took some completed genomes and we had Illumina data, we assembled it. We're losing about 80 to 90 KB of genome data. You know, it could be collapsed repeats, but it could also be, you know, short unresolved regions that just get chucked out of the assembly. So the markers that we did find, even though we think that it's probably not a comprehensive list, these are 38 markers that we think are pretty robust across different sequencing platforms, different assembly algorithms. These are things that anybody should always find, hopefully. And so these are the ones that we wanted to move forward into our diagnostic assay. So the assay that I'll be talking about today again is this AMP-seq assay. And so AMP-seq is just a high throughput analysis of multiplex amplicons, with the idea being you develop all these targets. So we have, you know, targets that we want to diagnose Burkholderia pseudomallei. We have near neighbor loci. We have amplification controls. We have MLST. We've also worked in virulence loci, antimicrobial resistance loci. So the idea is if you can optimize all these primers to work together, you can take a DNA and in one PCR reaction, you can amplify up all these primers, sequence them really cheaply and kind of a massively parallel, and you can get a lot of information about your organism based off of this. So it's a cheap, rapid assay. We have an analysis pipeline called ASAP that's still a little rough to use for people who don't know how it works exactly, but it's a way that these things can be processed in parallel as well, so you can process the data and get actionable reports at the end. The thing we like about our assay is that it's redundant. So, you know, with that core genome reduction, if some of these targets were to drop out of future sequencing, you have enough redundancy in there you can still identify and make a positive call. The database, the sequence is actually databaseable as well. So if you have a qPCR assay, you know, you want to share those curves with someone else, it doesn't make a lot of sense. But here you can take the data and you can share with collaborators, you can put it in public databases, other people can analyze it. So it's kind of nice in that way that it's reproducible. And then we have some ideas that it could be used for strain-specific characterization. This is useful for clinical specimens or environmental samples where the organism is there in a very small quantity, but we could potentially do strain-level characterization as well. So the process relies on this idea of universal index amplicon sequencing. So it's a pretty simple concept, but the idea is you have a locus, you have a specific target priming site primer for that locus, and at the end of the primers, you can synthesize on these universal tails. So the universal tails are compatible with Illumina adapters. So in a simple ligation step, you can extend with those, with you know the specific index that you want to add in, and all of a sudden you have an indexed amplicon that then go on the sequencer. So the nice thing about this approach is it's you know it's ready to sequence, as well as the primers are very adaptable. So instead of having to synthesize a primer with your gene-specific primer, your index all in one, which can be quite expensive, you sequence a smaller portion or you synthesize a smaller portion, and then you just trade out whatever primers or indexes you want to use. So it's a very versatile system to mix and match indexes. So the first step was to validate these primers against a small sample set, make sure that the amplicons were doing what they're supposed to do. So in this context, the blue means that a lot of the reads mapped from the AMP-seq. Yellow means very few did. These are the different species up along the top, and then these are the different targets that we looked at. So the Burkholderia, you know, pseudomallei targets, they're basically just hitting pseudomallei. There's some off-target effects that we think are actually due to mixtures that we encounter in the lab. The BP plus mallei are hitting pseudomallei plus mallei. The near neighbor targets are hitting exactly what they're supposed to. The virulence loci are kind of intermittent, but we expected that. And then it's also present potentially in some near neighbor genomes. And then the MLST are hitting across, as we would expect, because those MLST loci are shared across different species in the genus. So as a first kind of pass and validation, it looked promising in terms of we're getting the amplification that we expected to find. So the next step was to screen it against that large isolate collection, so about 1,650 Burkholderia pseudomallei isolates. These are the different targets here. These are what it was targeting. The sensitivity, so this is just pseudomallei in the parentheses is mallei. So the pseudomallei were very sensitive, very specific. The mallei were a little less so because in mallei you have these really old strains that have been in the laboratory that have lost even more portions of the genome to the point where they've lost a lot of these diagnostic targets. So the mallei is a little less, performed a little less well, but we have, for pseudomallei, we're getting very good results across a large isolate screen. So the next step then was to take those assays and screen them against soil samples. And so on the top here, you have a CT value. This is a relatively low CT, about 20 going up to 35. This is a kind of a single genome copy equivalent range right here. And when you look at this at a really low CT, meaning the target DNA is pretty concentrated in your soil sample, we're getting very reliable, robust detection. As you move out to single genome copies, we're getting much less concentrated results. So the take home of this is that we're getting good amplification when the organism is there at high concentrations, but we think there might be something confounding with other organisms in the sample, especially near neighbors that might be kind of soaking up some of the reed coverage that are present more abundantly in the soil. So these near neighbors are present all over the place in soils. They're present in the United States, they're present in Australia. And so we think that they might be sucking up some of the bandwidth in this environmental screen. So now taking this to a clinical sample, and so again, the CT value on top, pseudomallei, and low CTs, we're getting very robust amplification. We're not getting pretty much anything in the near neighbor targets. But even at the single genome copy, we're getting some amplification. So in these cases, you're never going to see all of the targets amplify, just due to kind of stochastic reasons. But we get enough amplification and enough redundancy in our assay that we can make positive calls and say, this patient is definitely infected with pseudomallei. So these types of samples, they were collected from blood, urine, sputum. And so there's also some variability in the clinical matrix that was best for detection. So it turns out urine is a really good clinical matrix for detecting Burkholderia pseudomallei. Blood didn't perform quite as well. I think serum was maybe a little bit better. But so some of this variation is in terms of matrix. Some of it is just random amplification. But in most cases, even a single genome copy, we felt pretty confident that we could detect the pathogen from the clinical matrix. So the last part that I'll talk about is in terms of strain level classification. And so, you know, this is important if you have an outbreak event or you want to do, you know, source attribution. If you have that weaponized Francisella strain and you have an environmental one, you can see, is it the weaponized strain or is it something quite different? And so, you know, strain levels of classification be quite important. So what we've kind of been working on recently is this idea of a minimal spanning set. So a lot of these genomes that we've sequenced, we understand the population structure pretty well. We've sequenced hundreds of genomes from diverse locations. We can put them into a phylogeny. We know how they're related. And so the idea is we can use those SNPs that kind of separate the different populations. We can isolate those regions, put them into one AMSeq assay, and then by doing that, you can get all those SNPs recovered back at the back end, and you can place your sample in a phylogenetic context. And so this is kind of how many sites are needed. So the question is how many sites are needed for the different pathogens. So it's variable based on the organism. For pseudomallei, it breaks it down into about 60 informative sites that can give us pretty decent strain level resolution. And so this paper is in review right now. So the idea is once you get those SNPs, we can use it with this WGFAST method, which we publish for strain level characterization. So it turns out if you couple these two, if you do a good job designing your SNPs up front, and you use a method that can characterize them, you can get accurate strain level characterization pretty well. And this can be really important with metagenomics. So if you have your organism is present in really low quantities in a soil, in a blood sample, you don't need very many SNPs, and you're using an amplification procedure. So instead of sequencing the whole sample to a really high depth, you can go in with one PCR reaction and get that strain level characterization, as well as lots of other information as well. And so if we look at the results by comparing whole genome sequencing, where we knew what the genome was, we went back with this this AMPSeq approach and then kind of compared the phylogenetic position. This is pseudomallei, as we can see, here's the whole genome sequence, here's where the AMPSeq was placed, so right next to them, the phylogenetic tree. Again, same issue here, we're getting high placement with the AMPSeq and the whole genome sequencing, and the same issue here. So in general, even though in this case we didn't design these SNPs for phylogenetic resolution, just by happenstance, they seem to be performing pretty well. We've gone back with the minimal spanning set approach, and it's actually looking even more promising across the known phylogeny. When we go to clinical samples, this is a case where you want to see, you know, was this patient infected with this strain that was circulating in the region? So in this case, we have whole genome sequencing. The AMPSeq put it right in here with these organisms from the same sequence type. So this is from the same patient. And in this case as well, so same patient with the UT AMPSeq as opposed to the whole genome sequencing. So we think it's a promising approach for strain level characterization if you do a lot of work up front for defining your target and then really choosing those SNPs in a way that best explains the phylogeny. We've done this for E. coli as well. Seems like it's very promising. All right, so the conclusions. So there's core genome reduction effects that need to be taken into account when you're designing your assay. You're going to see this in almost every species where there's a certain amount of erosion in the size of the core genome over time. There's also this idea of signature erosion. So for many of the pathogens that we study, going out and obtaining new samples from the environment, near neighbor samples, and characterizing those are going to help you reduce the amount of false positives that you have to worry about, especially when you're thinking about select agents. The sequence data that we generated from the near neighbor genomes is a resource. So not only did it help us in terms of formulating better diagnostics, but we identified 5 new species. We've kind of shown how the transfer of mobile genetic elements is a real problem. It's you know, quite frequent between different species, including some of these ones that we greatly expanded, Ubonensis, Vietnamiensis, and it could cause potential large problems in diagnostics. The AMP-seq assays, I hope I show that they're rapid, it represents a rapid, potentially cost-effective method for screening large numbers of isolates, getting a lot of information for a relatively low cost from our samples. And hopefully, you know, in some cases, providing actionable information. If you have a pseudomallei infection, if you can detect it in your urine at, you know, 1 to 5 genome copies, you can start treatment right away. So hopefully by understanding that, it can provide to, you know, improving human health and actionable information. So the project was really a large collaboration between lots of different institutes. So either providing strains, so we had lots of folks providing strains from around the world, different types of analyses. You know, we went to folks in Thailand, we worked with PacBio to sequence some of our strains. And the funding was provided by the Defense Threat Reduction Agency. We're trying to get additional funding right now to hopefully, especially with this Francisella tularensis, try to define that near neighbor space to cut down on those false positives for detection in the BioWatch program. All right, well, that's all I have, so I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.